Hello and welcome to How to Econ. Today we will talk about a topic that every country cares about, which is economic growth. Let's begin with a brief overview of spectacular economic growth patterns around the world in the last two centuries. We commonly refer to this as the period of modern economic growth. Rapid and sustained economic growth is a relatively recent experience for the human race. Progressive, powerful economic and institutional changes started to have a significant effect in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. These are the results of industrial revolutions, which refers to the widespread use of power-driven machinery and the economic and social changes that resulted in the first half of the 1800s. Ingenious machines, the steam engine, the power loom, and the steam locomotive performed tasks that otherwise could have taken vast numbers of workers to do. The Industrial Revolution began in Great Britain and soon spread to the United States, Germany, and other countries. The Industrial Revolution led to increasing inequality among nations. Some economies took off, whereas others remained close to a subsistence standard of living. By 1960, the most developed economies had 4.2 times the GDP per capita of the poorest economies. However, by the middle of the 20th century, some countries had shown that catching up was possible. Japan's economic growth took off in the 1960s and 1970s with a growth rate of real GDP per capita averaging 11% per year during those decades. Certain countries in Latin America and Southeast Asia experienced a boom in economic growth in the 1960s and 70s until now as well. Economic growth depends on many factors. Key among those factors is adherence to the rule of law and protection of property rights and contractual rights by a country's government so that markets can work effectively and efficiently. Laws must be clear, public, fair, enforced, and equally applicable to all members of society. Property rights are the rights of individuals and firms to own property and use it as they see fit. The definition of property includes physical property as well as the right to your training and experience, especially since your training is what determines your livelihood. Using this property includes the right to enter into contracts with other parties with your property. Individuals or firms must own the property to enter into a contract. Contractual rights then are based on property rights, and they allow individuals to enter into agreements with others regarding the use of their property, providing recourse through the legal system in the event of non-compliance. Without a legal system that enforces contracts, people would not be likely to enter into contracts for current or future services because of the risk of non-payment. This would make it difficult to transact business and would slow economic growth. Sustained long-term economic growth comes from increases in worker productivity, which essentially means how well we do things. In other words, how efficient is your nation with its time and workers? Labor productivity is the value that each employed person creates per unit of his or her input. More productivity essentially means you can do more in the same amount of time. This in turn frees up resources for workers to use elsewhere. What determines how productive workers are? The answer is pretty intuitive. The first determinant of labor productivity is human capital. Human capital is the accumulated knowledge from education and experience, skills and expertise that the average worker in an economy possess. Typically, the higher the average level of education in an economy, the higher the accumulated human capital and the higher the labor productivity. The second factor that determines labor productivity is technological change. Technological change is a combination of invention, which is advances in knowledge, and innovation, which is putting those advances to use in a new product or service. The third factor that determines labor productivity is economies of scale. Recall that economies of scale are the cost advantages that industries obtain due to size, which means average cost per unit decreases when quantity level increases. An economy's rate of productivity growth is closely linked to the growth rate of its GDP per capita, although the two are not identical. For example, if the percentage of the population who holds jobs in an economy increases, GDP per capita will increase, but the productivity of individual workers might not be affected. Over the long term, the only way that GDP per capita can grow continually is if the productivity of the average worker rises, or if there are complementary increases in capital. A common measure of US productivity per worker is dollar value per hour the worker contributes to the employer's output. This measure excludes government workers because their output is not sold in the market, and so their productivity is hard to measure. It also excludes farming, which accounts for only a relatively small share of the US economy. Productivity growth is also closely linked to the average level of wages. Over time, the amount that firms are willing to pay workers will depend on the value of the output those workers produce. If a few employers try to pay their workers less than what those workers produced, then those workers would receive offers of higher wages from other profit-seeking employers. If a few employers mistakenly paid their workers more than what those workers produced, those employers would soon end up with losses. In the long run, productivity per hour is the most important determinant of the average wage level in any economy. Nothing is more important for people's standard of living than sustained economic growth. Even small changes in the rate of growth, when sustained and compound over long periods of time, make an enormous difference in the standard of living. Consider the example in this table, in which the rows of the table show several different rates of growth in GDP per capita, and the columns show different periods of time. Assume for simplicity that an economy starts with a GDP per capita of 100. The table then applies the red formula to calculate what GDP will be at a given growth rate in the future. For example, an economy that starts with a GDP of 100 and grows at 3% per year will reach a GDP level of 209 after 25 years, that is 100 times 1.03, then raised to the power of 25, and the answer we get is 209. This example shows that even a few percentage points of difference in economic growth rates will have a profound effect if sustained and compound over time. For example, an economy growing at a 1% annual rate over 50 years will see its GDP per capita rise by a total of 64%, from 100 to 164 in this example. However, a country growing at a 5% annual rate will see almost the same amount of growth, from 100 to 163 over just 10 years. Rapid rates of economic growth can bring profound transformation. Let's take a look at another example. If Botswana had a GDP of $44.3 billion in 2019, with a sustained growth rate of 2%, estimate its future GDPs in 5 years and 10 years. If you want to give it a try, please pause the video now. Otherwise, keep watching. We use the compound growth formula again to answer this question. So to get the future GDP level, we take today's GDP level, times 1 plus the growth rate, and then raise to the power of how many years that we look into the future. For Botswana's GDP 5 years from now, we take GDP today, which is $44.3 billion, multiply with 1 plus the growth rate of 2% per year, and then raise to the power of 5 years. We get the potential GDP 5 years from now is $48.9 billion. For Botswana's GDP 10 years from now, we take GDP today, which is $44.3 billion, multiply with 1 plus 2%, and raise to the power of 10 years. We get the future GDP 10 years from now is $54 billion. This is pretty easy, huh? Let's bring it up to the next level in the following example. This example is about Tunisia. It is designed to help you practice the compound growth formula. You can use that formula to estimate current or future GDP levels, the time that it takes a nation to achieve a certain level of GDP, and the growth rate that it needs to get there after a certain amount of time. If you want to give this a try, please pause the video now. Otherwise, keep watching. And here is the answer. Did you get all the answers? It is okay if you did not get this right away. It might take some practice to get used to this kind of calculation, but nothing too intimidating here. Over decades and generations, seemingly small differences of a few percentage points in the annual rate of economic growth can make an enormous difference in GDP per capita. In this module, we discuss some of the components of economic growth, including physical capital, human capital, and technology. The category of physical capital includes the plant and equipment that firms use, as well as things like roads, also called infrastructure. Again, greater physical capital implies more output. Physical capital can affect productivity in two ways. First, an increase in the quantity of physical capital, for example, more computers of the same quality. And second, an increase in the quality of physical capital, same number of computers, but the computers are faster and so on. Human capital refers to the skills and knowledge that make workers productive. Human capital and physical capital accumulation are similar. In both cases, investment now pays off in higher productivity in the future. In short, technology comprises all the advances that make the existing machines and other inputs produce more and at a higher quality, as well as altogether new products. It includes new ways of organizing work, like the invention of the assembly line, new methods for ensuring better quality of output in factories, and innovative institutions that facilitate the process of converting inputs into output. When society increases the level of capital per person, we call the result capital deepening. The idea of capital deepening can apply both to additional human capital per worker and to additional physical capital per worker. Since the late 1950s, economists have conducted growth accounting studies to determine the extent to which physical and human capital deepening and technology have contributed to growth. For studies of the U.S. economy, three lessons commonly emerge. First, technology is typically the most important contributor to U.S. economic growth. Growth in human capital and physical capital often explains only half or less than half of the economic growth that occurs. New ways of doing things are tremendously important. Second, while investment in physical capital is essential to growth in labor productivity and GDP per capita, building human capital is at least as important. The third lesson is that these three factors of human capital, physical capital, and technology work together. Workers with a higher level of education and skills are often better at coming up with new technological innovations. These technological innovations are often ideas that cannot increase production until they become a part of new investment in physical capital. New machines that embody technological innovations often require additional training, which builds worker skills further. While physical and human capital deepening and better technology are important, equally important to a nation's well-being is the climate or system within which these inputs are cultivated. Both the type of market economy and the legal system that governs and sustains property rights and contractual rights are important contributors to a healthy economic climate. A healthy economic climate usually involves some sort of market orientation at the microeconomic, individual, or firm decision-making level. Markets that allow personal and business rewards and incentives for increasing human and physical capital encourage overall macroeconomic growth. Much of the rapid growth since the late 19th century has come from harnessing the power of competitive markets to allocate resources. This market orientation typically reaches beyond national borders and includes openness to international trade. A general orientation toward markets does not rule out important roles for government. There are times when markets failed to allocate capital or technology in a manner that provides the greatest benefit for society as a whole. The government's role is to correct these failures. In addition, government can guide or influence markets towards certain outcomes. For instance, government invests in education and infrastructure, encourages investment and scientific research, and opens special economic zones to support international trade. Some low-income and middle-income economies around the world have shown a pattern of convergence in which their economies grow faster than those of high-income countries. Will this pattern of economic convergence persist into the future? This is a controversial question among economists that we will consider by looking at some of the main arguments on both sides. Several arguments suggest that low-income countries might have an advantage in achieving greater worker productivity and economic growth in the future. A first argument is based on diminishing marginal returns. Even though deepening human and physical capital will tend to increase GDP per capita, the law of diminishing returns suggests that as an economy continues to increase its human and physical capital, the marginal gains to economic growth will diminish. For example, raising the average education level of the population by 2 years from a 10th grade level to a high school diploma while holding all other inputs constant would produce a certain increase in output. An additional 2 year increase so that the average person had a 2 year college degree could increase output further, but the marginal gain could be smaller. Yet another additional 2 year increase in the level of education so that the average person could have a 4 year college bachelor's degree could increase output still further, but the marginal increase could again be smaller. Low-income countries tend to have lower levels of human capital and physical capital, so an investment in capital deepening should have a larger marginal effect in these countries than in high-income countries, where levels of human and physical capital are already relatively high. Diminishing returns implies that low-income economies could converge to the levels that the high-income countries achieve. A second argument is that low-income countries may find it easier to improve their technologies than high-income countries. High-income countries must continually invent new technologies, whereas low-income countries can often find ways of applying technology that has already been invented and is well understood. This phenomenon is called the advantages of backwardness. Finally, optimists argue that many countries have observed the experience of those that have grown more quickly and have learned from it. Moreover, once the people of a country begin to enjoy the benefits of a higher standard of living, they may be more likely to build and support the market-friendly institutions that will help provide this standard of living. If the economy's growth depend only on the deepening of human capital and physical capital, then we could expect that economy's growth rate to slow down over the long run because of diminishing marginal returns. However, there's another crucial factor in the aggregate production function, which is technology. Developing new technology can provide a way for an economy to sidestep the diminishing marginal returns of capital deepening. With the combination of technology and capital deepening, the rise in GDP per capita in high-income countries does not need to fade away because of diminishing returns. The gain from technology can offset the diminishing returns involved with capital deepening. Will technological improvements themselves run into diminishing returns over time? That is, will it become continually harder and more costly to discover new technological improvements? Perhaps one day, but at least over the last two centuries since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, improvements in technology have not run into diminishing marginal returns. Modern inventions like the internet or discoveries in genetics or material science do not seem to provide smaller gains to output than earlier inventions like the steam engine or the railroad. The argument that it is easier for a low-income country to copy and adapt existing technology than it is for a high-income country to invent new technology is not necessarily true either. When it comes to adapting and using technology, a society's performance is not necessarily guaranteed, but is the result of whether the country's economic, educational, and public policy institutions are supportive. In theory, perhaps, low-income countries have many opportunities to copy and adapt technology, but if they lack the appropriate supportive economic infrastructure and institutions, the theoretical possibility that backwardness might have certain advantages is of little practical relevance. Although economic convergence between the high-income countries and the rest of the world seems possible and even likely, it will proceed slowly. Consider, for example, a country that starts off with a GDP per capita of $40,000, which could roughly represent a typical high-income country today, and another country that starts off at $4,000, which is roughly the level of low-income countries like Indonesia, Guatemala, or Egypt. Say that the rich country chugs along at a 2% annual growth rate of GDP per capita, while the poorer country grows at the aggressive rate of 7% per year. After 30 years, GDP per capita in the rich country will be $72,450, that is 40,000 times 1 plus 0.02 raised to the power of 30, while in the poor country, it will be $30,450, that is $4,000 times 1 plus 0.07 raised to the power of 30. Convergence has occurred. The rich country used to be 10 times as wealthy as the poor one, and now it is only about 2.4 times as wealthy. Even after 30 consecutive years of very rapid growth, however, people in the low-income country are still likely to feel quite poor compared to people in the rich country. Moreover, as the poor country catches up, its opportunities for catch-up growth are reduced, and its growth rate might slow down somewhat. The slowness of convergence illustrates again that small differences in annual rates of economic growth become huge differences over time. The high-income countries have been building up their advantage in standard of living over decades. Even in an optimistic scenario, it will take decades for the low-income countries of the world to catch up significantly. That's it for now. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.